Let's commence our study of meiosis by looking at the end products of meiosis, and those would be the female reproductive cells, commonly an egg, and the male reproductive cells, commonly a sperm. And the important thing to remember is that haploid sperm and haploid eggs, which contain one set of chromosomes, haploid means one set, whereas diploid means two sets, the haploid egg and the haploid sperm are produced by a two-division process that we call meiosis, a two-cell division process. And in that process, the chromosome set is cut in half. And it's easy to see why that would be true, because if it weren't, then when fertilization occurred, you would double the chromosome complement compared to the previous generation. And so if carried over a number of generations, this would yield an unwieldy number of chromosomes and genome. So there must be a cutting in half of the chromosome set to produce a haploid egg and a haploid sperm, so that when they are united in fertilization, diploidy is restored. And we have then we have two sets of chromosomes, one paternally inherited through the sperm and one maternally inherited through the egg. And that each pair of chromosomes then has a maternal homolog and a paternal homolog. But it's important to remember that not all organisms have sperm and eggs. For example, let's look at the single cell alga here, Chlamydomonas. Chlamydomonas exists in most of its life cycle as a haploid cell, and only when pond conditions that the Chlamydomonas lives in deteriorates do gametes, differentiation occurs of single celled organisms into gametes. And so these are all 1N haploid cells, and they divide by mitosis until pond conditions deteriorate, and there is a signal which allows the formation of plus cells and minus cells, which fuse in a process called that we'll call fertilization to produce the 2N zygote. And that 2N zygote sporulates or becomes resistant to a desiccation and can exist in a dried out pond for long periods of time. And when a pond is restored to favorable environmental conditions by rain or other factors, then these 2N cells will undergo meiosis to produce 4 haploid cells. And those haploid cells are happy to exist and reproduce by mitosis for most of the life cycle. So in Chlamydomonas, we don't really have sperm or eggs. We have plus or minus cells that unite in fertilization only under certain conditions. And they, again, under certain conditions, meiosis will proceed to produce, to restore haploidy in this case. Organisms like frogs have a reverse type of life cycle, and humans for that matter as well. There, sperm and eggs are produced, and the haploid part of the life cycle, existing as sperms or eggs, exists for only a very short period of time until fertilization, when the zygote forms and develops into an adult eventually, which will become sexually active and will produce gametes in the process of meiosis. And that would be true for humans as well. We exist most of our lives as diploid 2N individuals, and at meiosis we produce haploid sperm or haploid egg that are united during fertilization to restore diploidy in the next generation as a zygote. And the phenomenon of sexual reproduction, which demands that meiosis reduce the chromosome number by half, is begs a question, and that is the first question is, why is there sex at all? And so let's consider that for a moment. So the first question, why is there sex at all, we can address by considering what is the advantage of sex? And that actually has been a problem for biologists. So if you have a population, let's call it population one here, and another population two here. And population two consists of males and females, whereas population one only has females that reproduce by asexually, by cloning. Let's start out with two individuals in this population and two individuals in this population. One male, one female, and here we have two females. Well, these two individuals can breed, and let's say every generation they produce two individuals. So this is generation one, and in generation two, let's say they produce two individuals. Well, here we'll say these two females each produce two individuals as well, just like this female in generation one produced two individuals. So here's generation one over here, generation two. If each of these two females produce two more females, then we would have four. So we would have four individuals, all of which are female here. We're dealing with a completely female population here. And here we have one male and one female. Here, let's say that we get an equal sex ratio, 50-50 sex ratio. In this generation, we will have two individuals produced, each of which will be, let's say one of which will be a female again, and another one of which will be a male. So already you're seeing that even in generation two, we are producing more individuals in the asexually reproducing population compared to the sexually reproducing population. In a way, males are very costly because females are the ones with eggs that can support embryogenesis. Males are just contributing sperm, which can't support embryogenesis. So the sexually reproducing population produces fewer individuals than the asexually reproducing population. Consider these four females over here, each of which would produce two females in the next generation. So we would have eight individual females produced in generation two, or in generation three rather. Over here in generation three, if we've got a female and a male, each female produces two individuals, we'll get two more individuals in generation three, and we would have one male here and one female. And all you have to do is add up the total number of individuals here to immediately see that this population increases faster exponentially than this population will. And therefore, the asexually reproducing population would outcompete the sexually reproducing population. So asexual reproduction produces many more progeny than a sexually reproducing population would be, and therefore asexually reproducing organisms should wipe out sexually reproducing organisms. So what is the advantage to sexual reproduction? Why is it, what have been the selection pressures that have given rise to sexual reproduction? Well, the best answer that evolutionary biologists and theorists have come up with, it seems to hold true, is that what sexual reproduction does is it increases genetic variability. And we'll see why that is true as we proceed in our treatment of genetics variability. It increases genetic variability. Whereas asexual reproduction is basically reproduction by cloning. So that what we have are genetically identical individuals and asexually reproducing populations or organisms. Now there are examples of asexually reproducing organisms, dandelions, the whip-tailed lizard, and there are many more. The rotifer family has 500 species, all of which reproduce asexually. But clearly sexual reproduction has had some evolutionary advantage, and the evolutionary advantage is that genetic variability is produced. And what does that genetic variability, how does that genetic variability endow offspring with superior competitive advantages to those produced by cloning, by asexual reproduction? And the answer lies in that we have parasites. All organisms essentially have parasites. There are viruses, there are bacteria, in some cases there are fungi. There are organisms that parasitize other organisms. And when you have an asexual species or an asexually reproducing population, there is little genetic variability, and therefore the parasites can home in on a particular arrangement of genes, a particular molecular signature, if you will, of the asexually reproducing populations. Whereas, as we will see, the genetic variability that sexual reproduction provides for allows offspring to display a variety of molecular signatures and denies parasites an easy route to infect all individuals in the population. And this is why we think sexual reproduction has been favored in many, many cases. And the evolution and this genetic variability providing an escape from parasites has provided an advantage to sexual reproduction. And so it provides a selective advantage. So that is why there is sex. But now there's a second question that is begged, and that is, if you're going to have sexual reproduction, why are there two genders? Why is there always a plus and a minus? Why can't pluses mate with pluses and minuses with minuses? Why do we need two genders for sexual reproduction? Couldn't there all be one gender? And that's what we'll pick up with in the next part of this lecture.